Good morning, Open Door Church. Put your hands on it.
Of the land,
there is power,
wonder,
wonder,
Jesus. How priceless, how precious. There's power in the blood of Jesus. How priceless,
how precious.
Lift it up, voices.
There's power.
Talk to your neighbor. So expensive.
There's power in the blood of Jesus.
I was thinking about it this morning. And how expensive it is. How expensive it would be for us to make a decision to go back. How expensive would that decision be? For us to make a decision to go back. When God already paid the price for us. It's so expensive for us to make the decision to go and sin or make the decision to turn our backs on God. But he already paid it on the cross for us. He already did it on the Calvary for us. And so this is why we worship you. This is why we glorify you. This is why we honor you, Jesus. Yeah. This is why we glorify you. This is why we worship you, Jesus. This is why we glorify you.
Drenched in love. That's the name of the song, and it's just so, so inspirational. We're drenched in love.
Everything's possible
by the power of the Holy Ghost.
how many are grateful that we serve a God who's never lost a battle. He is the King of glory. He is the Lord God strong and mighty. He is the Lord God mighty in battle. And he's never been defeated. He's never been defeated.
Hallelujah. Father's Day. Give God the glory on this Father's
Hallelujah.
Day. There's somebody hurting because maybe they didn't have a good father. There's somebody that's hurting. Maybe their father wasn't there or things that you couldn't control. But God's going to heal that heart today on this Father's Day. Amen.
Yes.
And there's a reason that we don't put our trust on humans and earth. It's all about our Heavenly Father. Our Heavenly Father is the only Father who will never let us down, amen? And guess what? He's a good, good Father, amen? I can hardly speak. still and you call me. Deeper still and you call me. Deeper still into love. Love you like Jesus. Won't nobody be there like our Father in heaven? It doesn't matter what you've done in your past. He accepts you as you are. Hallelujah. He's a good, good Father. Ain't nobody gonna love you like God. Hallelujah. What manner of love is this that he'll lay down his life for his friend? That's who he is. Just worship God right now, church. Just put the worship God right now. Think about how good he's been to you. When did nobody want to have nothing to do with you, he was there. When your mother turned their back on you, your kids turned your back, but he was right there. And he's a good, good Father. Hallelujah. 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 Get your mind on Jesus.
Who can attest that God is a good, good Father? I know some of you can say that you know, experience, some of you have experienced having a good, good father. Some of you, like me, I didn't have such good of an earthly father. My earthly father had 8 children with 7 different women. And do you know, my earthly father lived probably like, I would say like 20 minutes from where I live. He never took care of me or my sister or any of his children. But do you know, he got sick in 2009. He needed brain surgery. He had some sort of tumor. And who was on the first plane? When he got out of surgery, he became a vegetable because they botched up the surgery. But who was right at his side taking care of him? He became a child. He didn't know who I was. He didn't know who my sister was. He didn't know anybody. He ended up dying in 2010. But I just want to say, we were the ones there to change his Pampers at the hospital, to help him out. But he never took care of us. But it's okay, because I always look to Jesus, because the Bible says, look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith. The Bible says, what kind of father is he if his child would ask for bread, that he will give them stone? And if they ask for fish, he would give them a serpent. Do you know how good God is? He's saying, if our earthly fathers know how to give us good gifts, wouldn't he, who is God, God Almighty, God all-powerful, God all-knowing, a good, good, good father, give us all things, just treat us way better than our earthly fathers have treated us? You know, you need to look to Jesus every day. Every day. The Bible says, lift up your heads. Are you lifting your heads this morning? Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lifted up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. He says, who is this King of glory? Do you know this morning who is the King of glory? It says, the Lord strong and mighty. The Lord mighty in battle. He is the King of glory. Put your hands together for the Lord today. Good Father, Jesus, the only true and living God, the King of kings, the Lord of lords, the great I am, the infinite God, you are our good Father. We thank you today. You are perfect in all your ways, as the song says. And I remember Monty sang a part in the song that says, he knows what we need before we even ask. What kind of father is that? He's amazing. Wouldn't you say he's amazing? He's mighty. He'll fight your battles for you. He'll take care of everything that you need. His word says it, that he will supply all of your needs according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. Father, we just thank you this morning. We thank you, God, for good fathers. We thank you for bad fathers, because God, you use them, even though they were bad, you use them so that we can be here on this earth, Lord. So we thank you for even the ones that are not so good, Lord. Father God, we praise you this morning. God, we glorify your name this morning, Lord. Father, we thank you, Father, for fathers, for the amazing fathers. There are a lot of amazing fathers out there, Lord. And we just thank you for them. We thank you for taking, for them, Father God, taking care of their children. We thank you, God, for them being the priests, Father God, in their homes, Lord. We thank you, God, for those fathers, oh God, that's, Lord, being a great example to their children, Father God. Oh, Father God, we just ask you to bless them today, Father God. We know, God, they don't get a lot of recognition, a lot of fathers on Father's Day, Lord, that we hype up Mother's Day, God, and we don't hype up Father's Day. But, Father God, we just love our fathers, God. We praise you this morning, and we bless your name. Put your hands together for the Lord.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, the presence of the Lord is definitely here this morning. Our good, good Father's presence is here this morning. Amen. Well, welcome to Corona Church of the Open Door, the fastest growing church in all of the world for the glory of God. Amen. Amen. All right. Only two people believe. For the glory of God. Amen. 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 Well, happy Father's Day to all the fathers today. It is so good to see you all. If you are a father, if you could please raise your hand. We just have a little something special for you that we wanted to give you. So if you could please raise your hand, we're going to send somebody to your seat. You got one? Okay. Did anyone not? You got one? Awesome. Okay. Oh, we're on our stuff today. Okay. Well, hallelujah. Happy Father's Day to all the fathers. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. Is there any first-time visitors in the house this morning? Any first-time visitors? All righty. Okay, so that means this week we need to be inviting people to our great church. Amen. So as you're out in the store, at work, or at the nail shop, whatever you're at, just invite somebody to come to our church. Amen. I'm just going to go over a few things that we have going on during the week. Monday morning, we have 5:30 Mountain Move-In Monday. It's a prayer at 5:30, and Pastor Fred does that on Mondays. I said that at 5:30. It's via Facebook and YouTube, so please join, please share, do hearts and all that. I don't have Facebook, so I don't know what it is, but please share and do all that, please. And then on Tuesdays, we have Tuesday Night Through the Scripture at 7:30. So please join us again. Share the links. It's such a blessing to go through the scriptures and just learn and gain knowledge of our God. You know what I mean? And to learn more about his promises so that we have more tools in our toolbox to get us through the week. Amen? So please join us on Tuesdays as well. We do have a baptism coming up next Sunday, you guys. Who's getting baptized next week? Because we only have a couple people on the list. So we're doing a baptism next Sunday. It's the 25th at 5 p.m. It's going to be at New Hope Church. Please sign up. There's a sign-up sheet on the Connect booth. So if you know somebody or you want to be baptized, please put your name because we want to have someone reach out to you this week. Amen. Amen. Well, please like us again on Facebook and YouTube. And again, we are a bilingual church. If you know anybody who speaks Spanish, please invite them because we have the capability of interpreting for them. Amen. Amen. At this time, we're going to continue with worship with Carla.
Thank you. Good morning. Happy Father's Day. Thank you so much. And happy Father's Day to the man of the house. Thank you, Pastor. Thank you so much. All right, so I'm just here to continue with our worship. One of the other ways that we show our worship is to follow the instruction that's been given to us. So today I'm just going to read out of 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 through 8. So it says, "Remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver, and God is able to bless you abundantly, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work." So that verse is just giving us the instruction right there. When you give, give wholeheartedly, give with joy, don't give reluctantly. I think The part of this that it really stands out for me is the joy part. So when you're giving, like when you go to a party and you have a great gift that you're going to bring to a loved one, let's say today, Father's Day, you want to give your dad the best gift, the best whatever you have to give. And so that's how we should come into the storehouse. We should come with our best. We should come excited. We should come ready to just give the Lord what is his. We need to give him what's his. And just thinking about sowing too. Recently, I teach summer school right now, and the kids that I have, we were planting little flowers, and some of the kids only wanted to put like one or two seeds, and then the other kids wanted to plant like the whole bag. And I'm like, wait. You got to make sure that when you're planting, you are prepared to plant. So you have to teach a kid how to plant in a planter. So just like the word is teaching us, we're God's kids, how to plant. When you're planting something, you got to be prepared for the harvest. So you have to have the right weather, the right temperature, the right seed, the right area so that your plant, whatever you're harvesting, is going to come to fruition. So with your giving also, as we're going to work and we're getting our paychecks, you got to get that seed ready so that when you go in to plant, it's ready to harvest. And you got to expect the harvest too. Every time you give, that's you watering. Every time you show up, that's you maintaining your plant. That's you maintaining your harvest. So with that said, we will go ahead and take up our offering, but we will also do our declaration. So if you guys can stand with me and we'll do our declaration over our tithes today. All right, so 1, 2, 3. We're believing for healthy marriages, healing from illness, financial freedom, and a debt-free life. We're believing for families to be restored and children to come back to the Lord. We're believing for prison sentences will be reduced or overturned and for favor with the court systems. We're believing for the start of new businesses, buying new homes, and release of all state tax liens. We're believing for $2 million cash for J2L. A seed will leave your hand, but it will never leave your life. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
How many know that God reigns? Yeah. Sing with me. Here we go. Sing, my God reigns.
My God reigns.
Our God reigns.
Our God reigns.
Lord, you reign.
Power and magic.
To be the
have an amazing worship team. Give it up for them. They're so great. Yes. And with that said, we are going to go ahead and get our Father's Day service started. We have many guests coming up this morning. And our first guest is actually, before we start, let me pass it over to our Pastor Fred. Here we go.
I'm sorry. Let's give Carla a hand, please. Happy Father's Day to all the fathers in the house. And those who are watching, happy Father's Day to you as well. Now, I want you guys to be with me. I want you to give a warm applause to the best musicians that we have, in the world. I thought I was at a jam session. I love my musicians. That being said, I'm excited on this Father's Day because, you know, 5 is the number of grace. You know, God created everything, the earth, everything in it. And then he made, Jake, then he made man on the 6th day. And he gave man dominion over everything that he made in the 5th day. So 5 is grace, getting something that Adam didn't work for. He didn't deserve it. But because of God's grace, he gave it to him. So 5 is the number of grace. That being said, that's the inset way to, we have 5 anointed pastors or speakers who will be speaking today. Come on, give them a hand, please. I am, Vanessa, I am beaming with anticipation of what God is getting ready to say through these young men. And if I was to fall off, I'm going to get out of the way. Ian, if I was to fall off this earth today, literally, because the Bible says your life is like a vapor. So I don't know. But if I fall off this earth today, I know that this church will be strong. It will continue to give bread, food, which is the word of God. Matthew 4:4, a man shall not live by what? But what? And you're going to get some word, some bread today. So I want you guys, each speaker that comes up, all boats rises to the tides. It's a big wave that's getting ready to come up right now. So just give each one of them, when they come up, anticipate. Yes. Cheer them on. Yes. Cheer them on. Amen. Right, Ian? Yes. So with that being said, we'll bring up our first speaker, Darion. Yeah. Come on, come on, come on, come on. They each have 7 minutes. And now if they go a little bit more, you hear a little music, that means that, okay, that's their sign. All right? Amen. So come on, Darion, Pastor Darion. Come on, give him a hand.
Amen, family. Good morning, Open Door Church. Good morning. All right. Do we have any young people in the house? Yeah. Whoa. Okay, I'm going to ask you to do something really quickly. We are here. Praise the Lord. Let's, I would love to, if you have an iPhone, did anybody, who has an iPhone in the house? Can you put your AirDrop on for me? Praise the Lord. We gonna follow through. Holy Spirit, have your way. AirDrop on, everybody. All right. The reception, no people are found on my end. So, okay, I have an iPhone, I have Rib, I have ATZ. I'm going to share all of this with everyone, all right? All right. And then if you don't have an iPhone, share with your neighbor. Say, hey, neighbor. Hey, neighbor lady. All right. This is trial and error. Praise God. But while that is coming to you, hopefully it comes your way. I just wanted to get started with sharing some of the word with you. So if you can open up to Luke chapter, let me see. It's going to be Luke 15, 11 through 32. It can't be a Father's Day without a prodigal son. Hallelujah. And if somebody else is speaking on this, it's okay. We're going to lift them up. So you're already loved. You're already loved, right? Did it come through for anybody by any chance? Nope. Okay. That's totally fine. All right. Okay, so thank you, Jesus. All right. So that's what it's doing for me. Praise God. We're going to move forward. And then if it comes through, I'll share it with you eventually. There's nothing that you can do to win the love of God. There's nothing we can do to win the love of God. If we're open up to Luke 15, I'm going to pull it up right now. It says, to illustrate the point further, Jesus told them this story. A man had two sons. The younger son told his father, I want my share of your estate now before you die. So his father agreed to divide his wealth between his sons. 13. A few days later, this younger son packed all his belongings and moved to a distant land. And there he was wasted all his money in wild things. About the time his money ran out, a great famine swept over the land, and he began to starve. 15, he persuaded a local farmer to hire him, and the man sent him into the fields to feed the pigs. The young man became so hungry that even pods he was feeding the pigs looked good for him to eat. But no one gave him anything. 17, when he finally came to his senses, he said to himself, at home, even the hired servants have enough food to spare, and here I am dying of hunger. 18, I will go home to my father and say, Father, I have sinned against both heaven and you. 19, I am no longer worthy of being called your son. Please take me as a hired servant. 20, so he returned home to his father, and while he was still long way off, his father saw him coming. Filled with love and compassion, he ran to his son. Embraced him, and kissed him. His son said, Father, I have sinned against both heaven and you. I'm no longer worthy of being called your son. How many of us ever get to that point? Like, we just feel like we're not worthy to even worship God. We're not even worthy to even come before his presence. And God is like, hey, son, here I am. He came with an embracing kiss, an embracing hug. He said to him, but the father said to the servant, quick, bring the finest robe in the house and put it on them. Get the ring for his finger and sandals for his feet, and kill the calf we have been fattening. We have to celebrate with a feast. For this son of mine was dead and has now returned to life. He was lost, but now he is found. So the party began. 25. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field working. When he returned home, he heard music and dancing in the house. And he asked, what's going on? Dad said, your brother is back. He was told, and your father has killed the fattened calf. We are celebrating because his safe return. 28. The oldest brother was angry and wouldn't go in. His father came out and begged him, but he replied, all these years I've slaved for you and never once refused to do a single thing you told me to. And in all the time, you never gave me one young goat for a feast with my friends. Yet when the son of yours comes back after squandering your money on the prostitutes, you celebrate by killing the fattened calf. 31, his father said to him, look, dear son, you have always stayed by me and everything I have is yours. We had to celebrate this happy day, for your brother was dead and has come back to life. He was lost, but now he is found. Is that my time? Praise the Lord. So I just want to make sure I share the prodigal son with you because you're already loved. And no matter what the situation is, no matter how you feel, there were 3 points. I'll just give them to you really quick. You're already loved. And 2, run your own race. I'm not sure what the race looks like for you, but it's very important that your relationship with God is your relationship with God. Don't look to your left. Don't look to your right, because God has already have a blessing of the perfect plan for your life. Last thing. He never missed a day. He never missed a day. Some of our earthly fathers miss days. Some of the biggest moments of our lives, you know, we get let down. But God, our Father, has never missed a day. He's never missed a day. And we can hold fast to that. We can hold true to that. So God bless you. Hopefully, when I sit down, maybe it'll come through on your phones. Take a look at it. It's a video of my son and his obedience and how my littlest boy, how he wanted to do things his own way. He wanted to get out the car his own way. He said, I can do it. And he's getting out the car, and then he gets halfway and he's like, Daddy, help me. And I just want to share that with you, that oftentimes we walk that same life out where we're like, I can do it. And then we get to trouble. We're like, God, help me. And so I just want to encourage you that God is there. He's saying, I'm there all the time. I've been there offering, extending my hand to you, saying, I'll help you whenever you need it. God bless you. Have a good day. Happy Father's Day. This is my brother. Come on, let's give it up for my brother, Big Benny. Come on, Bishop.
How's it going, CCOD? That time went by kind of fast, man. Okay, I got that. So what I wanted to talk about was a father's foundation in faith. I got my notes, bear with me, because you know my mind can be like a beehive sometimes. It'll just be buzzing up and down. So as young as I can remember, my family's upbringing has always been grounded in the Word of God. Whether that been a devotion, a Bible study, vacation Bible school, men's youth group, my father always made sure that we had that community and that we were plugged into that community. It's so funny, I can remember even as a kid, my dad would come to the room, knock on the door, and be like, Benny, are you going to church? It was a rhetorical question. I knew we were going to church. I knew we were going. And oftentimes when I would ask my father for advice, he always had a wise word to give. But at the end of the conversation, it would always be like, well, Benny, ask God, pray to God. And sometimes when you're raised in the church, you're like, well, Dad, I don't want to talk to God. I want to talk to you. But my father, a righteous man, had the wisdom to know that he knew where to guide me, but he knew the Lord knew where to take me. Because after all, it's my relationship with God. If I'm talking to God, Sam can't come in like a conference call and be like, well, Lord, Benny does this way and that way. So he just made sure that I had to build that relationship up for myself. Mm-mm-mm. So I pulled from a passage from 1 Chronicles 28 and 10, or no, 28. It's 1 Chronicles chapter 28, verse 9 through 10. And it's between David and Solomon. It's when David was the end of his run. David made a lot of plays for the kingdom, but his hands was a little dirty. So when it came to building the temple for the Ark of the Covenant, he had to pass that down to his son Solomon. And to me, this is just a perfect example of just a father, what biblical fatherhood looks like, and just passing knowledge down to your son. So it goes in 1 Chronicles 28:9-10. And you, my son Solomon, acknowledge the God of your father and serve him with wholehearted devotion and with a willing mind for the Lord. The Lord searches every heart and understands every desire and every thought. If you seek him, he will be found. But if you forsake him, he will reject you forever. Consider now, for the Lord has chosen you to build the house as the sanctuary. Be strong and do the work. Man, powerful stuff. And then it goes down to 1 Chronicles 28 and 20. David also said to Solomon, his son, be strong and courageous and do the work. Do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord my God is with you. He will not fail you or forsake you until all the work of the service of the temple of the Lord is finished. And to me, this is just a great example of biblical fatherhood, because it's like, son, this is the plan. This is how you execute. Work hard, but if God is not at the forefront of it, then nothing's going to work. And obviously, the details to build this temple, if you read the passage, it's very detailed to the gold, to everything that he needed. But before any material was mentioned, before he even laid out the blueprint for Solomon, he let him know that God has to be the foundation. And our children, well, I guess as a father, you look at your children as your temple, and we want to build them up because obviously our bodies are a temple of the Holy Spirit. But we know first we need that foundation. And so that's the way my father raised me. That's how I tend to raise my children. And that's the cycle that I want to keep going on. And I don't know if I went over my time or under my time. Am I right in the pocket? I still got 2 minutes. Oh, man. Honestly, that's kind of all I have. Well, I guess I can tell a funny story. All right, so this is just if you can just go into the mind of Sam Letcher and how he raised me. I was trying to go to a school dance or something, and I forgot to mow the lawn. It was something like that. And my dad was like, I was like, Dad, could I please go to the dance? Begging more than I've ever begged before. And then my dad was like, you know what, Benny? I deliberately told you to mow that lawn. You disobeyed me. You don't deserve to go, but I think I might let you go. And I was like, man, really? I was like, you said, that's called grace. It's what God gives us every day. And I was like, man, I like this. Grace feels kind of good. And then I was like, Dad, you really gonna let you go? He said, boy, no. When I tell you to do something, you need to do it. And that's all I have for you guys. Thank you.
Where's Ben? Ben, that totally makes, I just see your dad just sitting there saying that too. Hello, everyone. A couple things. One, happy Father's Day to everyone, right? Number two, thank you to Pastor Fred and Pastor Karen for giving us this opportunity. It's pretty cool. And then number three, I want to apologize because I couldn't help out Pastor Darion with his thing. So I just want to make sure it wasn't him. It was the tech guy. So it's all good. Woo! All right, here we go. So friends, I'm going to pose a question to you this morning. How well do you know your father? So we're going to go to we were asked to speak on Luke 15, the prodigal son. And you all, I mean, Darion read it, so y'all should be familiar with it. But we're going to go to the latter half of it, and we're going to touch briefly on the prodigal son, and then we're going to focus a little bit on the son who was at the house. Amen. So we all know prodigal son. He, you know, if we want to use terms speaking on what Pastor Fred and Pastor Karen have been speaking about, let's look at us as each of the children and obviously God as the father, right? So the prodigal son prayed to his father, Father, give me what you have. Give me my covenant blessings. Give me what I have here. And God said, okay, cool, take it. He took it. Our father, God, knows our intentions, right? So he knows that if we're going to hurt ourselves with it too much, he's not going to give it everything. But he will give us stuff so we can learn a lesson, right? So he, guy goes, he does it. He's like, ooh, yeah, making it rain, making it rain, making it rain. Ends up back at the pig pen, right? So now all of the blessings that God has given him have, you know, dried up, right? And now he's sitting here in a famine, right? Whether it be pandemic, whether it be in his mind, whether it be wherever. And he's trying to fill it with the things of the world, the things of the pigs, the things of the pods. So whether that be alcohol, meaningless sex, whether that be TikTok, social media, whether it be whatever it is, something that's filling that hole that only God can fill, right? And then he gets rock bottom, right? He has that conviction. Holy Spirit, I'm saying it, it doesn't say here. Holy Spirit comes in and is like, bro, what are you doing? Like, come on, bro, let's go. He comes to his senses and he remembers his father. He remembers how good his dad is, saying, I'm here, but the people who are least in my father's house or my dad's kingdom are in this position. What am I doing out here outside of his presence? I need to go back. Goes back to grace, goes back to mercy, goes back to what Jesus did on the cross for us so that we can go back and atone. He did that. Let's look at the other brother. How much more time I got? Five. Oh, man, Ben, this time does go by quickly. Okay, here we go. All right. So now we're here with the brother. So comes back. Dad's like, okay, cool. Hi, son. I saw you from far off. Blah, 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 blah. Party's happening, right? They're, ooh, getting it, getting it, getting it, getting it, getting it. The other son is like, I hear music in the background. What's going on? And so he goes, asks the guy, the servant. The servant's like, hey, man, your brother came back, this and this and this and this and this. And he starts feeling some type of way, right? Okay, well, I'm not going in there. Why would I celebrate with my brother? Why would I celebrate with my sister who was out in the world and I've been here in the presence of God? I've been here in church. I've been here serving and doing all this. I'm not going to, whatever. So the father comes out, obviously as a good father, wanting all of his children, regardless if they're in the church or not, to get along, because he loves each and every one of them, right? And so he goes and he's like, hey, son, what's going on? Like, why aren't you coming in? And so we're going to pick it up right at Luke 15. 25. Here we go. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing, so he called one of the servants, and he asked him, what's going on? Your brother has come, he replied, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound. Here we go. The older brother became angry and refused to go in, so his father went out and pleaded with him. He pleaded with his son, but he answered his father, look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. I've tithed. I've remained pure. I haven't let anything, I haven't become, I haven't been a drunkard. I haven't, I've stayed in devotion time. I've served in the house, right? So look, all these years I've been slaving for you. I've never disobeyed you. Yet you never gave me anything. You never even gave me a young goat so I can celebrate with my friends. But when the son of yours who was out squandering your property with prostitutes come home, you kill the fattened calf for him, right? So he's like, put it in layman terms, right? Okay, I've been here. I've been doing all this stuff, God. But now you have, I see their Instagrams. I see the conversations. They're out there just doing whatever, okay? They're out there getting high. They're out there doing this. They're not giving their tithes. They're doing this, doing this, doing this. And now you're going to let them come back in this house, and you're going to give them even more, and I haven't received anything? What are you doing, right? So then the father says, my son, the father said, you are always with me, and everything I have is yours, but we have to celebrate and be glad because your brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. Okay, let's wrap this up here, right? So the father has to remind the son, right, that one, you're all my children, okay? Regardless of what's going on and what's going on, you guys have two different aspects. Your brother was gone. He was out of my life, right? But he has now come back. Wow, I had a better tie-in than that. Wow, okay. Holy Spirit, help. Here we go. Anyway, so the question I want to ask you guys is, how well do you know your father? Do you know that your father loves everybody equally? Do you know that he is no respecter of person? Do you know that No matter what someone else is doing, that's their journey. God has them on that path for a reason. Do not, compare yourself with anyone else. Do not understand what your father's relation, you should have a relationship with your father, and it shouldn't be duplicated, it shouldn't be imitated or anything because of anyone else, right? So what I want to ask you, and I want to encourage you to do, is to continue to dig down deep in your relationship with God, right? Continue to stay in his presence. And then check your motives also. Why are you doing what you're doing? Is it ritualistic? Is it religious? Are you doing it because you actually want to spend time with God because you know he's a good father and he loves you and he sent his son to die for you? Or are you doing it because he can probably give you, well, not probably, he can because he has a cattle on 1,000 hills, but he can give you the desires of your heart. And are you just trying to use him as a genie? Okay? Yeah, just think about it, okay? How well do you know your father? Okay, I'm out. So I want to go ahead and introduce the brother with the fingers of a guitar, Santana, popping up over here. Got Jose coming up next.
Hello, CCOD. Yo, I promise you, they all stole all my notes. I don't even know what else to say at this point. It's been said. I'm just kidding. I got something for you guys. So I'm going to speak also on the prodigal son, which is what we were asked to do, kind of just break it down from different perspectives. And I want to speak on the characteristics that this man has as a father. I want to speak also on the obedient brother that stayed behind and how that shows. It paints a much better picture of what kind of father this man was. Because if I like tell you guys, this story could have been said without the brother that stayed behind. Like, there was mostly a focus of the brother that left, he was lost, came back, and the father that accepted him back. The brother being there tells me a little bit more about who this father, like, what kind of father he was, you know? So I want to talk about, point out some characteristics that our father, that this father kind of showed, which shows protection, correction, strength, leadership, yeah, provider, authority, yes, guidance, love, and comfort. Yeah. Wow. What speaks to me a lot is the guidance and the comfort in this story. Yeah. Do you guys remember, like, if you guys had that beautiful memory of your father or a father figure teaching you how to ride a bike, and we get to the point where, like, we think we got it, like, Dad, let me go. But if you pay attention, your dad's going to listen to you. He's not going to argue with you. He's just, okay, you think you got it, you got it. I'm going to let you go. But if you look at it from another point of view, your dad's still right behind you, yeah, trying to make sure that you're not going to fall when you're going to fall, yeah, right? And so this child, the prodigal son, and I know we can bring it up. It's 15 verse 20. He fell, and he fell hard, right? He was completely lost. But that characteristic correction came from the father. When he came to himself and he said, well, how many servants does my father have that can eat much better than I'm eating at this point, right? And he arose and he came to his father, but when he was yet great off, And when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants does my father have bread enough to spare? And I perish with hunger. So he corrected himself. He's like, I need to go back to my father. And I'm gonna beg for mercy and beg for forgiveness, not knowing whether he was gonna be accepted or not. We don't, you know, because he knew he sinned against his father. And he went back. And let's go to 18 and 19, please. Or I'm sorry, 20. And he arose and he came to his father, and while he was still a great way off, his father was doing one thing, which was waiting. And this is one of the things I forgot to mention at the beginning. The story of the prodigal son, if I could reword that title, it would be the story of the waiting father, right? Because the father was waiting, just patiently waiting and hoping that his son would come back to him. And this one, he came back to him, and with compassion, he ran. He kissed him, fell and kissed him, right? So that's where you show comfort and love, like in one of the characteristics, or some of the characteristics that come to life in this story. And now going to the obedient son. All the characteristics are proven through the son that did stay behind. Because this father basically raised two children in the right way, because one of them stayed behind. He was completely obedient. That's what's proving to me that this man was a great father, almost a perfect father. One of them just decided to rebel, which is what we all do when we have the most perfect father. At some point in our lives, we have strayed away from the path. We rebel and say, we got it. And we fall. We don't know how hard we have fallen. Some of us have fallen really, really hard. And luckily, through the grace of God, we are forgiven. And when we come back to the Lord, he will not turn away from us. As this one did not turn away from his son. The last two that I have that I'm going to share is the love and comfort part. When he went up to him and kissed him, and he comforted him with the best cloak, right? He just, this is what I want to do. I want to wrap you up, make you feel warm and welcome again. And I'm going to throw the best party for you because my son was lost and is found. My son was dead and is now alive. So I just want to encourage you, if you guys ever, inevitably we're going to fall, hopefully not ever again. But if we know, if you know somebody that believes that there's no way out for them, there's always going to be a way out for them. Encourage them. Please encourage them to come back to the Lord. They will not be turned around. They will be wrapped in love. They will be clothed with the best robes, and they will not be turned away. So I'll leave you guys with that, okay? Thank you. And now we have, if you guys are going to pay attention to one person, please pay attention to Pastor Monty today, okay? So.
Praise the Lord. Happy Father's Day. We don't have a lot of time, so we're going to get right to it. Amen. Okay. The prodigal son. Amen. First, what is the definition of a father? One who protects and cares for someone. That's the first thing. Protection and care. He touched on that. Amen. Let's keep going. Everybody knows the story. We didn't even went over it again. But let's examine what the word prodigal means. Does anybody know what the word prodigal means in 2 seconds? I'm going to tell you. It means to spend recklessly. So the prodigal son, he got his name from doing one thing one time. Because he went and spent all his money partying, doing this thing. And it became all about the big prodigal son. But let's dig a little deeper. I think he should have been called the resurrected son. Yeah. The son that came back to himself. We're going to get there. Oh, let's go. Luke 15 chapter 11 through 31. That's the whole story. But on verse 14, it says that after he had spent everything, there was a severe famine. You think he wouldn't have put some money in his pocket if he knew that there was going to be a severe famine? Yeah. He didn't know. When we in the world living for the devil, we don't know what tomorrow might bring. We don't know what's around the corner. Yeah. Amen. Amen. Let's go. Hallelujah. 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 The devil don't want us to know. He wants us to make a fool out of us. Yeah. Hallelujah. Romans 6:23, real quick, it says, for the wages of sin is, Does anybody know the Bible? The wages of sin is death. Amen. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. So he was stuck. He was broke and all his friends were gone. Yeah. Oh, it was good when he had his money. But when he got on E, when he ran out, guess what? So did his friend. Yeah. So did his people. Yeah. Hallelujah. How many know here that whatever the devil gives you is temporary? Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's go. Thank you, Father. Thank you. Hallelujah. So only what you do for Christ will last. Amen. The devil told him that his money was going to last forever. Go on and do your thing. Had him thinking he was the man. Yeah. Took his money, didn't leave the city, left the country. That's like me going, my daddy, give me all my money, I'm going to Russia. I don't know where I'm at. I don't know what to expect. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But see, this is what I want everybody to just grab a hold to. The 17th verse. You can just see when he what? How can you come to yourself when you are yourself? How is this even possible? Well, let me explain it, because sometimes we get so caught up in sin and living for the devil, we forget who we are. We forget where we came from. We forget who we are. So sometimes we got to come back to ourselves. And if he came back to himself, what would have happened to the prodigal son? Hallelujah, hallelujah. So sometimes we get so lost in sin until we leave ourselves. We can turn into someone else. Somebody we don't even know. No, we came up in the church. No, we've been doing this. But you know you're partaking in sin, and it's against God's will, but you're doing it anyway because you done left who you are. The prodigal son left who he was. Thank you, Jesus. He had to come to himself. And where was he when he came to himself? Rock bottom. Sometimes that's what it takes. Sometimes it takes losing everything to realize what you had and what God had given you, what he's taught you. Everybody here has some type of foundation in God. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. And somebody here that turned their back on him, right? But the story of the prodigal son was not about the prodigal son. It was about the love of the father. Yeah. Hallelujah. The love of the father after he did his thing. What happened? He came to himself. He said, hold up. I know who my daddy is. I know who my father is. And there's somebody in here right now that knows how it feels to lose a child. This father, like Brother Jose was saying, this father wasn't just sitting around and didn't forget about his son. He was on his knees praying, God, bring my son back. He never gave up on his son. Hallelujah, hallelujah. And because of the love that he had, I'm not even going to focus on his brother, because his brother, there's always going to be a hater somewhere. He had it all, and he was still hating, amen? Hallelujah, hallelujah. But we're going to focus on the Father, the love of the Father. Now let's think about us as a people, as a group, as his children. We're his children. When we turn our back on God, this is how he feels. He's hurting. But once his son came back, he said, look, God looks down to see somebody who hasn't been living for him on their knees. And he said, look, that looks like my son. That looks like my daughter. She's on his knees. She's repenting. Just like when that father, he looked over. He knew that was his son. Why? Because I know the way my son walked. I know his walk. Guess what? God knows your walk. God knows you, and God wants you not to be a prodigal. He wants you to be obedient to him. So when you come to him, he can accept you and give God the glory. Give God the glory. Pastor.
Great word, great word. Come on, let's give all the speakers a hand. I know 7 minutes, it's like 1 minute. But I wanted to each speaker to understand that when there's an urgency, it doesn't take long. And I truly believe that each and every last one, and Darion, I would like to say it's something about the first. Everybody else follow us after that. Okay, I can breathe a little bit. So I just want to say thank you. You did a wonderful job. I wish we could have saw that the baby, you know, because it's visual, and I got that. But see, half this church is not millennials, okay? What's the drop box? What's the drop box? What is he talking about? A drop box? But I saw the vision that he had. On this Father's Day, I just want to say to all the fathers that are here and those who are watching, maybe you may have been a father that you didn't do your best at the time that you could have. Just like the prodigal son didn't do the best as he could have. But you always have, like the prodigal son, you always have a father that is waiting for you to come back. Even if you had dropped the ball, I'm talking to someone out there now. Even though you have dropped the ball, you feel like I wasted my time. Like the prodigal son. But God is a God of the second chance. And if you could just, if you have to just send a text, or you have to just say, give the child that you were not a father to. You heard Dignus McCreer. Her father was not a good father. He had outside children, and he lived 20 minutes from her, and he never poured into her life. But because McCreer had a relationship with Jesus Christ, she was able to forgive her father. And in his dying days, she gave him grace and mercy. So these speakers, Ben, Jose, Pastor Darion, Monty, DeAndre, you guys did an amazing job. Come on, come on. And you know what? Joy Bennett, you know what? You know, the Lord just put it up and pressed on my heart. Some months have 5 weeks. And every fifth Sunday that the month has 5 weeks, I want to bring these guys back up. What would you guys want? Would you guys come out and support them? Because they have so much. It reminds me of me when I had to take the final exam at Cottonwood School of Ministry. You could either write a message, or you have 5 minutes to give a message. I gave 5 minutes, but I was so frustrated because there was so much left in me. So I understand. Stay hungry. Stay willing that you always have more to give. That's what I want you. So when you sit down, you think about what you forgot to say or you could have said. That's good. Come on, that's good. On this Father's Day, is there anyone here that has not accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior? And just because you're here, that doesn't mean that you've accepted Jesus Christ. Jesus had money bag, yo, God and the money. I went over a lot of people here. The young people know what I'm talking about. Yo, money bag? Okay, all right. Anyway, he had Judas watching the money. You can be in the presence of God and not know God. That's my point. So is there anyone here that has not accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior? All have accepted Jesus Christ. There may be someone watching. You've heard these anointed speakers give an account of the prodigal son. And they each extract a point that was so worthy to dwell upon. And if that's you out there, if one of them ministered to you, there's a number at the bottom of the screen, 951-245-1777. You can call that number and give information where we can contact you, and we'll have a minister will contact you within 24 hours and to walk you through the most important decision that you could ever make in life. I don't take this time for granted. We're not just going through motions. God has ordained this time for a season and a purpose, and God is a God of purpose. That's to you. If that's you,
All you have to do is repeat after me, John, Romans 10:9. That if I confess with my mouth and believe in my heart that Jesus Christ died and God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. Romans 10:9. And if that's you, you may be in the room by yourself. Have a self-talk. You talk to yourself all the time anyway. Joy Bennett and I was talking out before service today. We have conversations. I'm at home talking with myself what I'm going to do tomorrow. I'm going to call him. And that person say this, I'm going to say this. I'm just talking to myself. We all talk to ourselves. But you're in the room by yourself right now. And all you have to do is say, Lord Jesus, come into my life. I'm like the prodigal son. I've wasted my time, my energy, my finances. I'm a sinner. You have to admit it. I'm a sinner. I believe that you died for those sins. Now be my Lord and be my Savior. Thank you. I feel it in my spirit. I'm in the room by myself. I'm not talking to myself. I'm talking to God. In Jesus' name we pray. Call that number. Call that number. Amen and amen. Is there anyone here need prayer? You need to pray for your father. You need to pray for a friend. There's a fallen father. Or you a father, you praying that the friend of yours, or it could be you, have strength. This is for somebody right now. Thank you, Holy Spirit. There's someone watching, or you can be in here now. Your father may not be alive. He may be dead. But you're still harboring resentment. And God brought you here today. Those who are watching, you may be here. So that you can forgive that father. If that's you, I want you to put down at the bottom of the stream, that's me. If you need prayer, fathers, wives, sisters, brothers, if you need prayer, not only for father's situation, but you just need prayer, period. I believe on this Father's Day, there's a Father's Day anointing upon this service. I truly believe. My intercessors are praying now. You need prayer. You need a breakthrough. I'm going to say this, and then we can move on with service. Don't ever allow the devil to lie to you and say, I prayed about that before. Don't ever allow the devil lie to you. I prayed about that. Daniel prayed for 21 days. Thank God he didn't say that on the seventh day. Jesus says in Luke 18:1, men are to always pray and faint not. I'm praying personally for some things that I haven't seen manifest yet, Jake, but it will manifest. Come up now if you need prayer. Come up if you need prayer. You never get tired. Let me tell you, don't ever let the devil rob you. Come on, come up for prayer. Come on, 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 come on.